Welcome back, everyone, to apalrd teaches Proxmox through useful applications. Today we're going to take this little NAS that we're running Proxmox on and turn it back into a NAS. I know, shocking, right? So this started life as a NAS. We reformatted it and put Proxmox on it, and now we can't store files on it like a NAS anymore, just virtual machines. Sure would be nice if we could install Samba or something like that, use this thing for file sharing. Now I know a bunch of people are gonna be like, why don't you just pass through all your drives into TrueNAS and run TrueNAS? And that just sounds kind of dumb to me, because we have a perfectly working Linux system running ZFS. Why would we need to run a second Linux system running a second ZFS when we can just share that ZFS pool, right? That's what we're gonna do. Nice, low overhead way getting file sharing in Proxmox via a container. So come along on this adventure as we add file sharing to Proxmox. So we want to create file shares from our Proxmox system, and Proxmox does not have a way to do this natively. So we're going to create a container and then export that container storage over Samba or NFS. And to help us out a little bit so we don't have to deal with Samba manually, we're going to install a web GUI called Cockpit. Cockpit is a pretty simple and easy to use web interface for servers, and there are some modules available that will help us with Samba and NFS server management. So to get started creating a container, we first need a template to create the container from. So a container is basically like a complete Linux system with its own networking, users, and file system, but running within the same kernel as our root system. So we'll start by taking any of our storages over here. So local is a directory storage, so it's available for CT templates. That's what we need. And we're going to click on templates, and it'll show us a lot of the available templates we could download. So sort by package, and we want Debian 11 standard. We'll just click on download there. So what this just did is it downloaded a tar file that includes all of the root file system of a standard Debian system, but without the kernel and without the kernel modules, because those are always inherited from the host. So now that we have this, it's not even that big. We can create a container from it. And again, a container is like a namespace within our system. It's partitioned off, but it's not running its own kernel, it's not running its own drivers. But it does have its own networking, its own permissions, things like that. So we're going to call this fileserver. And because we don't need to give it any special permissions on the host, we're not accessing any hardware or anything like that, we're going to say unprivileged container. And this checkbox is a little bit misleading, because when you check it, it removes the privileges from the container. So when you uncheck it, it makes the container privileged. So we would like to leave this unprivileged, which is the safest option, and we'll leave nesting enabled. So what unprivileged does is it maps the user IDs in the container to be at a really high number. So normally the root user has access to everything. And in a privileged container, the root user in the container also has access to everything. But with an unprivileged container, the root user ends up at user ID 10,000. So they have no permissions at all in the host system. They can't do anything. So now we need to give our container a password. And you should probably pick something secure, but I didn't. Whatever. Now we can pick our template. So I'm going to click local again, because that's where I downloaded the template to. Pick our Debian 11 standard. So disks. The way I'm going to set this up, this disk is only going to contain the operating system, so it can be really small. And I'm going to make it 8 gigs and put it on the SSD storage, because the operating system likes to be on fast storage, even though it's really just containing the system services. We're going to add more storage for the actual storage we share over Samba later. So for CPU, unlike virtual machines, this is more of a limit than an allocation. So with virtual machines, it'll tell the guest that it has 2 cores, and it'll think it's running on a dual core machine. With containers, though, it knows it's running on however many cores we actually have, but it's only allowed to use 2 of them. And same with memory. This is more of a guideline and not a hard allocation. So if we were to give a virtual machine a 0.5 gig of memory, as soon as we start the virtual machine, it's taking 0.5 gig from our system and giving it to the VM. And with ballooning, it's possible to get some of it back. We've always hard allocated that memory to the virtual machine. And with containers, again, it's more of a cap. The container isn't allowed to use more than 512 megs. But if it's not using that, then it goes back to the host. And the kernel memory doesn't count here. So in most cases, you don't need much memory at all for containers, and 0.5 gig should be perfectly fine. network here, like I said, containers have their own networking, so we do have to give them IP addresses. In my case, I'm going to leave it on the default Ethernet and the default bridge. We haven't set anything else up yet on the Ultimate Home Server. So we have to give an IP address and a subnet mask and a gateway. And then same for IPv6. And DNS, usually I just leave that as use host settings. But if you want the container to have its own DNS servers, you can set that there. And just to confirm, we're going to go ahead. So now it's done. Let's start it up. It's not running. There we go. So unlike virtual machines, this is more like a shell than a screen. So with virtual machines, this is a rendering of the screen image on the virtual machine. But for containers, this is actually something we can copy and paste into, kind of like an SSH session, but direct to the container. So now we can log in as root. There we go. We're on a Linux system like any other. So Cockpit comes packaged with Debian, so it's super easy to install. But we have to enable the backports repository to get a more recent version of Cockpit. Or I guess we don't have to, but we would like a more recent version of Cockpit, so we're going to enable backports. So we're going to edit the file etc apt sources.list. And this is the file that tells the package installer on Debian where it can look on the internet to get its packages. So in this case, we have three different repositories: Debian Bullseye Main, Debian Bullseye Updates Main, and Debian Bullseye Security Main. And so we're going to add one more here. We're just going to copy Debian Bullseye Updates. So /debian.org/debian-bullseye-backports. And otherwise it looks the same as the other lines. So backports is basically a repository from the future version of Debian Bookworm, where they're taking packages that work well there and compiling them for Bullseye. So Bullseye people, which is the latest release as of this video, can get more up-to-date versions of packages. So then we save, yes. Then we'll do an apt update, as we like to do, and apt full upgrade. And it probably won't have anything to upgrade because we just downloaded the template. But we'll see if we have any updates to do. Nope, no updates. So now we can install Cockpit. So apt install. And now we need to tell it to use the backports repository, because files in the backports repository still have the same package name as they do in the regular repository. So we say -t bullseye backports. That tells us to go to the backports repository instead of the normal one. And then the package we want to install is Cockpit. And then the last thing is Cockpit by default will install some modules used for administering Linux systems. Things like changing the host name, changing network settings. And we don't want to include those because Proxmox is already going to manage our host name and our network settings. So we're going to say no install, so --no install recommends. Because those packages are separate packages from Cockpit, but they're recommended. So apt will automatically install them because it thinks we probably want them to, but we don't. So we'll hit enter. It'll say it'll take some space, and we say yes. And there we go. So one last step before we can log in is we need to allow root login. So there is a file called etc cockpit disallowed users. And that contains users which are not allowed to log into Cockpit. And by default, it includes root. So since we're going to change some settings, we're going to get rid of that requirement so we can log in as root. No need to restart anything. Just delete that. It should be good. So we navigate here to the IP address of our server, :port 9090. We get the usual self-sign certificate error. We approve that, and we log in. And there we go. We're in Cockpit. And as you can see, we don't have a ton of modules here. So we have user accounts and services. But what we would really like is something to manage Samba. So the three additional modules we're going to install are Cockpit File Sharing, Cockpit Navigator, and Cockpit Identities. So the first of these, Cockpit File Sharing, is designed to manage Samba and NFS. So we get a web GUI to manage Samba and NFS. Pretty simple. Pretty useful. The second one, Navigator, gives us a web browser to navigate the file system. So this, if depending on how you use it, can kind of replace something like Nextcloud. It's just a handy way of looking at the files in the file system by having to go into the command line. And the third one, Cockpit Identities, it's better than the default accounts because it can also manage Samba passwords, because Samba keeps its own copy of passwords because it has to use Windows-style password hashes. So anyway, we want to install all three of these, and they all have release here. So we're going to click on the latest release and go over here, find the deb file, and copy it. Then we're going to come back to our command line here and wget, paste in the deb file. Then we'll do that for the other ones as well. Find the deb file, copy it, wget it, and the last one. So we got the files downloaded. Now we can apt install .slash, so it's in the local directory, star.deb. And it's going to install a whole bunch of stuff now because it's going to install Samba. Samba's big. There we go. So we got one minor error here. It's not exactly an error. Basically, it said it couldn't delete the deb file when we were done because the user apt is what actually did the install, but the file is owned by root. So that's not really a problem. We'll just delete the files ourselves. So without even refreshing, we come back over here. Well, I guess we do have to refresh. Bam, look at that. New modules in Cockpit. Isn't that fun? So we click on Navigator here. We can see the whole file system. File sharing, we could configure. It's going to give us error here. It says Samba's misconfigured. So we're going to click Fix Now. And because we're root, it'll fix it now. And Identities. So now you will note we only have 8 gigs of storage here, so we need to add some storage. So one of the magical things by using containers instead of virtual machines is we are really flexible in what we can change on the fly. I can go here and change the amount of memory it has, then it'll take effect immediately. And I can add new disks without having to do any hot swap or setting up mount points ahead of time. So in this case, on this server, I have two different ZFS pools. I have the SSD pool and the hard drive pool. So what I could do is I could create a mount point on each of those and mount it to my file system. Then the container will have an amount of storage space in the ZFS file system on Proxmox. And so we're going to do that. So add mount point. So I guess we'll do dpool first, which is our spinning drives. Will be mount point number 0. We're going to mount it to mount rust. And how big do we want to give it? This is, again, a quota, not a size. So ZFS on the host system is going to manage this file system. And let's say, I don't know, 1,000. Sounds pretty good. And how about we add another one on the SSDs? So pick local ZFS. I don't know, give them 200 gigs. Mount fast. Boom. So now if I go back in a navigator here, mount, you can see suddenly I got these two... these two directories here. So to manage our access, I'm going to create a group of who has access to the spinning Rust drive. So we're going to create a new group and we're going to call it Rust users. And I'll create one for the SSD too. You can create as many of these as you want. Then I'm going to go back to identities, create a new user for myself. apalrd. And login shell. So it's very tempting to just say no login, but if you use no login, then the user can't log into Cockpit itself, which means they can't use Navigator. So we're gonna say bin bash for them. And we're gonna click the little plus button here to add a group. And we will add these guys to Rust users and SSD users. SSD users. Rust users. My face is in the way, but if I had my face, you can see the apply button. There we go. Now we got to give our guy a password. And it'll yell at you a lot if you don't give it a good password. But we don't really care that much. See, doesn't meet the standard requirements, but we can click apply again. And woo, look at that. One thing we can't forget before we leave this page is our Samba password is different from our regular password. This is going to drive you crazy. There's nothing we can do about this. Windows uses a different hash algorithm than Linux. Therefore, the passwords have to be kept separately. Therefore, Samba has its own password. So we just set our Linux password. Now we need to set Samba password. Same rules apply. If you have a weak password, you can just double click apply. There we go. So now that we have some users and some groups, we can make some file shares for them. So coming over here to file sharing, we can give our server a description, and then we can come down and hit the little plus button. So we'll call this Rust. Spinning Rust, not Rust. Again, if you want to use more fine-grained directories, you can create a subdirectory, or you can create a new mount point up in Proxmox. You can create a separate mount point for each share if you want. Not a bad way to do it. It's a pretty good way to do it. We're going to say Rust users, and so permissions. So Windows has its own special way of doing access controls, which is actually really quite good. And NFS on Linux adopted Windows-style ACLs, but Linux itself did not. So you, most of the time, you're going to want Windows ACLs. And what this will do is this will tell Samba to completely ignore file permissions on the Linux system and manage permissions itself. So if we check this box, Windows ACLs, all of the files on the Linux system will be owned by some user, and we don't really care who that user is. And Samba is going to keep track of access control on its own and manage that on its own. That means that if you also want to access the same files from somewhere else, you don't really know what the user is going to be, or the group is going to be, on the Unix style permissions. So the next option we have is Windows ACLs with Linux Mac support. In this case, Samba is going to try its best to map Windows permissions onto Linux permissions, and it might do a good job or it might not. The third option is to check this off entirely, in which case we purely use Linux permissions. And basically, you're going to end up setting advanced settings here to say, like, I don't know, create mask 0666 or something like that. And you're going to end up doing that on your own. So what I recommend doing for most people is setting Windows ACLs, unless you're also going to share the same share with NFS. This is probably your best bet. And then we hit confirm, and there we go. So make another one for SSDs. There we go. So now we got some shares. So hopping over here, it asks you for your username and password. You give it to it and you get logged in. You also get your home directory, which is kind of cool. And be careful though, because your home directory is going to be stored on /home, which is in the 8 gig root volume. Let me go on Rust here. Let's make some file. There we go. We got our navigator. Look at that. We got a file. That concludes our tutorial for today. Hopefully it worked out pretty well for you. Of course, I got more tutorials with this little Proxmox NAS coming along. Next up, we're going to do Jellyfin. How does that sound to you guys? Don't forget to subscribe if you want to see that one. As always, I have a link to my Discord server down below if you want to chat with me or suggest any ideas for future videos. There's probably going to be a blog post down there with some of the commands, although there's not that many commands this time. And as always, I will see you on the next adventure.